If I had only known the last time would be the last time, I would have put off all the things I had to do. I would have stayed a little longer, held on a little tighter. What would I give for one more day with you? There's a wound here in my heart, but something's missing. And they tell me that it's gone and healed the time. But I know you're in a place where all your wounds have been erased. And knowing yours are healed is healing mine. The only scars in heaven, it won't be long to me. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, that the only scars in heaven are on the hands that hold you now. No, the road you walk was anything but easy. Picked up your share of scars along the way. Oh, but now you're standing in the sun. You fought your fight and your race is run. The pain is all a million miles away. The only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven, yeah, are on the hands that hold you now. Not a day goes by that I don't see. You live on and on the better parts of me. Until I'm standing with you in the sun, I'll fight this fight and this race I'll run. Until I finally see what you can see. Oh, the only scars in heaven, they won't belong to me and you. There'll be no such thing as broken, and all the old will be made new. And the thought that makes me smile now, and even as the tears fall down, is that the only scars in heaven
hands that hold you now.
Good morning and welcome. I want to encourage anyone who can hear me out in the lobby who is still making their way in to come in. For those of you that may not know me, my name is Patrick and I have the privilege of being the lead pastor here at Calvary. Our service this morning is called The Nails of the Cross. It is a series of readings, a series of responsive readings in which you participate, silent reflection and prayer. And it is designed to help you enter more deeply into the meaning of this day and to think anew of the sacrifice of Jesus on the cross. When you came in, you should have been able to get one of these cards from the baskets out in the lobby. You'll see that there's a little spike in that. This is symbolic of the nails that held Jesus to the cross. It's symbolic of our sinfulness for which he went to the cross. So please hang on to these throughout the service. I want to invite you now to stand with me as we worship our God. In the words of the prophet Isaiah, "See, my servant shall prosper. He shall be exalted and lifted up and shall be very high. Just as there were many who were astonished at him, so marred was his appearance beyond human semblance and his form beyond that of mortals. So he shall startle many nations. Kings shall shut their mouths because of him. For that which had not been told them, they shall see. And that which they had not heard, they shall contemplate." Would you bow your heads with me? Lord Jesus, as we gather here this morning to remember, as we think of the cross, as we think of your sacrifice, as we think of the nails that held you to the cross. And these nails we hold in our hands, symbolic of our sinfulness for which you died. I pray that you would make the reality of the crucifixion come to life in our hearts. May we think afresh of what you have done, of your humility, of your grace, of your generosity, of your love, of your sacrifice. Holy Spirit, move among us. Speak to our hearts, our minds, our souls today, we pray. In Jesus' name, amen. You can remain standing.
As he stood accused, salvation, where your love poured out over me. Now my soul cries out, hallelujah, praise and honor unto
Jesus said, "Watch out for the teachers of the law. They like to walk around in flowing robes and be greeted with respect in the marketplaces and have the most important seats in the synagogues and the places of honor at banquets. They devour widows' houses and for a show make lengthy prayers. These men will be punished most severely." Let's read responsively. Oh God, help us consider our own pride and where it leads. Oh God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our pride hurts us and creates walls between us and others. Oh God, we know too that our pride hurts you.
You may have a seat. While he was still speaking, Judas, one of the 12, arrived. With him was a large crowd of armed with swords and clubs, sent from the chief priests and elders of the people. Now the betrayer had arranged a signal with them: "The one I kiss, arrest him." Going at once to Jesus, Judas said, "Greetings, Rabbi," and kissed him. Jesus replied, "Do what you came for, friend." Then the men stepped forward, seized Jesus, and arrested him. With that, one of Jesus' companions reached for his sword, drew it out, and struck the servant of the high priest, cutting off his ear. "Put your sword back in its place," Jesus said to him, "for all who draw the sword will die by the sword. Do you think I cannot call on my Father, and he will at once put at disposal more than 12 legions of angels? But how then would the scriptures be fulfilled that say it must happen in this way?" In that hour, Jesus said to the crowd, "Am I leading a rebellion that you have come out with swords and clubs to capture me? Every day I sat in the temple courts teaching, and you did not arrest me. But this has all taken place that the writings of the prophets might be fulfilled." Then all the disciples deserted him and fled. O God, help us to consider how we betray others, how we abandon them in their time of need, how we think of ourselves first. O God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our acts of betrayal hurt us and create walls between us and others. O God, we know too that our betrayal hurts you.
Please stand with us.
He became sin, who knew no sin, that we might become his righteousness. Messiah, Lord of
Jesus Messiah.
Then the mother of Zebedee's sons came to Jesus with her sons and, kneeling down, asked a favor of him. "What is it you want?" he asked. She said, "Grant that one of these two sons of mine may sit at your right and the other at your left in your kingdom." "You don't know what you are asking," Jesus said to them. "Can you drink the cup I am going to drink?" "We can," they answered. Jesus said to them, "You will indeed drink from my cup, but to sit at my right or left is not for me to grant. These places belong to those for whom they have been prepared by my Father." When the 10 heard about this, they were indignant with the two brothers. Jesus called them together and said, "You know that the rulers of the Gentiles lord it over them, and their high officials exercise authority over them. Not so with you. Instead, whoever wants to be whoever wants to become great among you must be your servant, and whoever wants to be first must be your slave, just as the Son of Man did not come to be served, but to serve, and to give his life as a ransom for many." O God, help us consider how we envy others, how we desire more than we receive, and seek to influence and rule over others. O God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our envy hurts us and creates walls between us and others. O God, we know too that our envy hurts you.
But the chief priests and the elders persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus executed. "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" asked the governor. "Barabbas," they answered. "What shall I do then with Jesus, who is called the Messiah?" Pilate asked. They all answered, "Crucify him." "Why? What crime has he committed?" asked Pilate. But they all shouted the louder, "Crucify him." When Pilate saw that he was getting nowhere, but that instead an uproar was starting, he took water and washed his hands in front of the crowd. "I am innocent of this man's blood. It is your responsibility." Oh God, help us to consider how we waver, how we seek to avoid responsibility and to blame others for our actions. God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our indecision hurts us and creates walls between us and others. O God, we know too that our indecision hurts you.
Please stand again for this.
See from his head.
Then he took a cup, and when he had given thanks, he gave it to them, saying, "Drink from it, all of you. This is my blood of the covenant, which is poured out for many for the forgiveness of sins. I tell you, I will not drink from this fruit of the vine from now until the day when I drink it new with you in my Father's kingdom." When he had sung a hymn, they went out to the Mount of Olives. Then Jesus told them, "This very night you will fall away on account of me, for it is written, I will strike the shepherd, and the sheep of the flock will be scattered." Going a little further, he fell with his face to the ground and prayed, "My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me. Yet not as I will, but as you will." Then he returned to his disciples and found them sleeping. "Couldn't you men watch with me for one more hour?" he asked Peter. "Watch and pray so that you will not fall into temptation. The spirit is willing, but the flesh is weak." He went away a second time and prayed, "Father, if it is not possible for this cup to be taken away unless I drink it, may your will be done." O God, help us to consider how we are cruel to others, how we malign and slander others, and add to the evil that comes upon them. O God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our cruelty hurts us and creates walls between us and others. O God, we know too that our cruelty hurts you.
Blessed are you when people hate you, when they exclude you and insult you and reject your name as evil because of the Son of Man. If you love those who love you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners love those who love them. And if you do good to those who are good to you, what credit is that to you? Even sinners do that. And if you lend to those from whom you expect repayment, what credit is that to you? Even sinners lend to sinners, expecting to be repaid in full. But love your enemies, do good to them, and lend to them without expecting to get anything back. Then your reward will be great, and you will be children of the Most High, because he is kind to the ungrateful and wicked. Oh God, help us consider how we show hate to others, how we fail to care for others, and make distinctions among them. O God, do not let us deceive ourselves. Our hatred hurts us and creates walls between us and others. O God, we know too that our hatred hurts you.
Hallelujah.
He was despised and rejected, a man of sorrows, acquainted with bitterest grief. We turned our backs on him and looked the other way when he went by. He was despised and we did not care. Yet it was our weaknesses he carried. It was our sorrow that weighed him down. And we thought his troubles were a punishment from God for his own sins. But he was wounded and crushed for our sins. He was beaten that we might have peace. He was whipped and we were healed. All of us have strayed like lost sheep. We have left God's paths to follow our own, yet the Lord laid on him the guilt and the sins of us all. He was oppressed and treated harshly, yet he never said a word. He was led as a lamb to the slaughter, and as a sheep is silent before the shearers, he did not open his mouth. From prison and trial, they led him away to his death. But who among the people realized that he was dying for their sins? That he was suffering their punishment? He had done no wrong and he never deceived anyone. But he was buried like a criminal. He was put in a rich man's grave. But it was the Lord's good plan to crush him and fill him with grief. Yet when his life is made an offering for sin, he will have a multitude of children, many heirs. He will enjoy a long life, and the Lord's plan will prosper in his hands. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of what he has experienced, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. These are the words of the prophet Isaiah as recorded in chapter 53, verses 3 to 11. When I read this passage, I must confess, I want to turn away. I want to ignore it. I want not to care. I don't want to have to admit that it was for my sin, that Jesus went to the cross, that it was my weakness he carried, that it was my sin that weighed him down. He was beaten, he was whipped, he was wounded, he was crushed for my sin, so that I might have peace. He had done nothing wrong, nothing. And yet his life was made an offering for sin, for my sin, for your sin, for our sin. It was the Lord's good plan to crush him and fill him with grief. It wasn't some random act of hatred. This was part of God's plan. The Father ordained Jesus' suffering. He who did not spare his own son but gave him up for us all, how will he not also with him graciously give us all things, Paul writes in Romans. The Father didn't spare his own son. He could have, but he didn't. He gave him up for us all. The Father allowed his son to go to the cross to bear all sins. When I read this, I think, how can this be good? There must have been another way. There must have been another plan. But there it is, plain as day. Scripture says it was the Lord's good plan. Not just a plan, but a good plan. And I can't fully grasp it. I can't fully understand it. As a father, as a grandfather, I cannot imagine the pain, the anguish that the father felt. to make a decision to allow his son to go to the cross. But it was the Lord's good plan. And because it was his good plan, Jesus embraced his suffering. My Father, if it is possible, may this cup be taken from me, yet not as I will, but as you will. He agonized in the Garden of Gethsemane over what was to come. Luke reminds us that in agony he began to pray more earnestly. His sweat became like great drops of blood falling to the ground. Yet not as I will, but as you will. Despite his anguish, the agony, and what was before him, Jesus embraced his suffering. He was beaten, severely beaten. He was whipped with a cord with shards of bone tied into it so that it would destroy his flesh. He was oppressed. He was mocked. He was treated harshly. And he never, never said a word. My Father loves me because I lay down my life only to take it up again. No one takes it from me. I lay it down of my own accord. John recalls these words of Jesus in his gospel. It was the Father's good plan. And out of love and obedience to his Father, Jesus lays down his life. Why? Why lay down your life when you are innocent? Why accept a punishment that someone else deserves when you have committed no crime? Why suffer for the sins of another? These are questions that we grapple with as humans. But this is not a plan formed out of man's wisdom. This is a plan of the Almighty Divine God. When he sees all that is accomplished by his anguish, he will be satisfied. And because of what he has experienced, my righteous servant will make it possible for many to be counted righteous, for he will bear all their sins. Those who made Jesus' death necessary, and that is each one of us, all of us, are the beneficiaries of his extraordinary act of kindness and love. He canceled the record of the charges against us and took it away by nailing it to the cross, Paul writes. Nailing it to the cross. Our sin is no longer held against us. In his agony, in his death, the record of charges against us has been taken away. Why lay down your life when you are innocent? Why suffer for the sins of another? In a word, love. Love, unlike any other love that we can or ever will experience. For God so loved the world that he gave his only son. Love, not the kind of love we experience as human beings in friendship or even in marriage, but a love that is an otherworldly love, a love that only God can share with us. Salvation from hell, forgiveness from sin, removal of guilt, deliverance from bondage, a restored relationship with God. We are the beneficiaries of all of these gifts and so much more because of Christ's sacrifice, because of his victory on the cross. Don't turn away. Don't turn away from the horror of that day. Don't ignore it. Acknowledge the truth that Christ willingly went to the cross for your sin, for my sin, for our sin as a part of the Father's good plan. Embrace the truth that it is only through this astonishing act of love, through the shed blood of Jesus Christ, that we are set free from the bondage and the penalty of sin. If you're watching online or you're here this morning and you've never placed your faith in Christ as Savior and Lord, perhaps now is the time to do so because he died for you. And if you've never done so and you want to receive him as Savior and Lord, you simply need to acknowledge your sin. And you need to repent, and repent means to turn away from it. But in turning away, you must turn towards something else. And that something is a person. It's Jesus Christ himself. Acknowledge your sin, turn to him. Ask for forgiveness from your sin. Acknowledge him as Lord and Savior. It is that simple. You don't have to clean up your act because you can't clean it up. Only he can clean it up. And so I invite you now, let's take a moment in silence and reflect on our relationship with Christ. We turn our attention now to the communion table. This is something that Christ instituted when he celebrated the Passover, the Last Supper, with his disciples. It is a holy time. It is a precious time. I want you for a moment just to take that card with the nail, or take that nail out, and just touch the end of that, the pointy end of it. And just imagine for a moment. I don't know if you can see clearly the spikes on that cross, but imagine for a moment that nails much larger than this were driven through the wrists of our Savior to hold him to the cross. To hold him to the cross. And he went willingly so that our sin would be forgiven. We're going to celebrate a little bit differently this morning. And if you are here this morning and you trust and believe that Jesus Christ is your Savior and Lord, then you are welcome to participate with us. If you haven't made that decision in your life, then I would ask respectfully that you just remain in your seat. This is a holy celebration for those who trust in Christ as Lord and Savior. We're going to do something a little bit different this morning as we celebrate. In just a moment, I'm going to ask that you just sit quietly, that you think of your sin, you think of the price that Christ paid, that you reflect, that you repent, that you confess if there is anything you need to repent or confess of. And you'll do that quietly just in your seat. And then as you feel led, I encourage you to come up either to the table in the center, or if you're on the side, to either of the tables on the side. One of the elders will be there to give you the communion. Remember, the bread that we will take represents the body of Christ given for us. The blood is represented by the little cup of juice, the blood that was shed for the forgiveness of sin. Remember the incredible sacrifice that Christ made for you. And so now we'll just simply turn our attention to him, to his sacrifice. Praying quietly, come up when you are ready. Come as a family, come as couples, come on your own, it doesn't matter. Take the cup, return to your seat, and then take it when you are ready, peeling back the cellophane for the bread and the foil for the cup. And then we will draw our service to a close by singing together once again. Let's bow our heads and pray. Lord, as we reflect in these next moments, as we participate in communion as you have instructed us to do, my prayer is simple. It is that your sacrifice would be made very real to each one of us. That we would recognize the enormity of what you have accomplished, what you have done. That you would make it fresh in our hearts and in our minds and in our souls. Lord, that we would not be able to celebrate this without feeling a sense of incredible gratitude, thankfulness. And Lord, that we could not ignore the fact that it was our guilt, our sin, that sent you to the cross. So now, Lord, as we pray quietly, as we reflect, we invite you to move among us. We ask this in your name. Amen.
Would you stand with us as we continue to reflect on that amazing love of our Father?
I just want to say a word of thanks to the tech team, to the worship team, for those that put out the chairs, everyone that has made this morning possible. And I want to encourage you to do something today and tomorrow as you leave this place today. Ponder what you've heard. Let what you've experienced through reading and singing and prayer, let it be something that you think about through this day. Imagine what it must have been like that day to see Jesus crucified. Imagine what it must have been like for his disciples, for his mother. And then tomorrow's such a weird day, the day in between Good Friday and Easter, the celebration of the resurrection. It's a day of waiting. For the Jews, it was the Sabbath day. For us, it's a day to ponder. It's that day in between. And imagine, put yourself in the place of the disciples. Imagine your rabbi, the one you have followed, has just been executed and laid in a tomb. Would he really rise, as he said? Would they have even understood what he meant when he said that? So imagine what it was like that day in between, waiting. Waiting for what we now know to be true, that he would be raised. Imagine how long that time must have felt. And then on Sunday, I want to invite you to come and join us at 9:30. Invite friends, invite neighbors, co-workers to come and join us at 9:30 a.m. as we celebrate the resurrection of Jesus. Because unlike the disciples on that day in between who may have been pondering what would happen, we know that he conquered death. We know that he is risen. And so we will gather on Sunday at 9:30 to celebrate that. But in the meantime, I invite you, if you like, to sit and reflect and pray if you want to following this service. And I encourage you to reflect as you go through the day today as well. I invite you to stand now. Lord God, thank you for being with us in these wonder-filled moments where we stand as witnesses, at least through what has been conveyed to us through your word. We stand as witnesses to your incredible sacrifice. And where we stand poised between life and death, filled with sorrow, filled with thoughts of what has been, and yet filled with such hope, because we have the privilege of knowing that you did indeed rise. Thank you for the gift of life that you give us, Father, in Jesus. Thank you that he is a gift to this world, a gift that has changed each of our lives and changed history completely. As we consider what happened on this day some 2,000 years ago, comfort us. Comfort us. Jesus, be our friend in this time of remembrance, in this time of sorrow. And we pray for your sustaining grace in the days to come. And we pray this in the holy name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. And all God's people said, amen. I would ask as you leave, if there are people remaining, that you would leave quietly, chat in the lobby if you like, but let's just leave it quiet in here for those that may want to reflect. God bless you as you go, and we'll see you Easter Sunday. Please.